where I'm in various different medical situations. I might be lying on my, you know, on my stomach, on my back, on my, and imagine trying to have to worry about this clunky machine to get in your face, to be able to see and have access to communication. That is what we hear most from the community, is that access to communication is ineffective, especially in medical situations. Hi, my name is Stuart Booth. Now, these are also stories we get from the community. Now, if we look at video remote interpreters versus real-time, say with live interpreters. Now, emergency situations. They should be calling the live interpreter, but the video remote interpreter can provide immediate access. The whole point is that the community, yes, wants that immediate access, but as soon as you get a live interpreter, they should be taking over. You shouldn't be relying on a video remote interpreting, because in those emergency situations, you don't know what kind of state people are in. And so, yes, it's a temporary solution, and that's all it should be. It should not be a permanent solution.
To get a licensure passed. The purpose of the licensure is to ensure that we have qualified sign language interpreters. You had made a comment earlier about having a family member interpret at a doctor's office. There was an incident once where a 12-year-old boy had to interpret for his deaf mother to tell her she had breast cancer. Can you just imagine? So that can't happen. And having family members, if I had a deaf family member as a sign language interpreter, it is against my professional code of conduct to interpret for my family member. We do have scarcity of interpreters in the state. We do have scarcity of interpreters nationwide, but that's a whole other subject that's taken out of what I can explain to. We are required to have national certification to work in very specific settings, medical, mental health, and legal. And as we will be talking about soon, is maintaining our license. We want to make sure that we have qualified interpreters, and yes, sadly, there is a shortage. Using VI interpreters, they are in any state, anywhere, and they should have Wisconsin state licensure in order to provide those services in the state, and many of them do not. Sign language is also, there are some aspects of sign language that are regional. So if you have a sign language interpreter from North Carolina in the hospital with you and you're signing a sign from Wisconsin, they might not know what that sign is. We need to maintain our licensure, we need to recruit more interpreters, we need to make sure that our profession is honored and respected by doctors and lawyers and dentists and clinicians and employers, simply providing interpreter services. So members of the deaf community can be employed, have their interviews, have their job training interpreted, but unfortunately many people in corporate offices think, oh, if I have to have an interpreter today, do you have to have an interpreter changing every day? No. Deaf people are fully capable of doing anything that we could do. Anything. We just can't hear. And for that they need a sign language interpreter. And that's what we're fighting for, the right to make sure that that's accessible to them.
Excellent. You are anyone else that can speak to building a bridge between our universities and maybe our colleges to finding the staff to be able to work for the state so we can provide those services and way more accessible than we are now?
Do you mean by providing computer training programs? Is that what
you're talking about? But so that we can have way more interpreters than we currently have.
Currently in Wisconsin, I believe we have. We had three interpreter training programs. UW Medical is a huge program, and they there is work available for interpreters who are not yet at that level. They can work in post-secondary environments, some job trainings, a lot of things of that nature. And as far as developing more interpreter training programs, that would unfortunately probably take a lot of time, a lot of money from the government to do such a thing. We do have to do continuing education once we are certified and we try out the interpreter training program. It's an ongoing profession and continual learning. So as far as bringing in more interpreters, one thing that we will be talking about today is replacing our current license, which would help us to hold on to more interpreters, because it would be a leveling in the new proposal, which would help us to maintain a greater number of interpreters.
Do we have students in the world who are in the interpretation program?
I believe we do, yes.
And I think I would like to say, sure, I'll just say thank you, everybody, for making the effort to come and ask you. And to be able to tell your stories, it's not easy to do. We should be on that. Amy's my constituent, and I'm sure she will be in contact with me.
They don't have access to their education right now. My oldest, she's been struggling with getting an individualized education program, the IEP. So many times they turn down services for her. Now, even though she's at level with her peers, they consider her gifted for her age, but at the same time, gifted doesn't mean you don't provide access to that student. She needs that access so that she can pick up the things that she's learning in her environment, and she needs access to communication. Deaf children need access to communication in their educational experience. It doesn't matter if they're deaf or if they're hard of hearing or deaf-blind. We want to make sure that all children with hearing loss have some form of communication access, interpreters, captioning, what may be. My daughter has had no interpreting services. My second daughter, she has had no interpreting services, and she uses American Sign Language to communicate. So she can't access her teachers and her peers. They denied her services for so long, and we've tried different routes, different diplomatic ways of getting her services. You know, they tell us we need to go someplace else to serve my daughter for education, but that's not the system that I want to live in. I want my child to have the education I want her to have. And she has an identity like myself, and I want her to keep having access to her world just as I have. Like, for example, she's in a K-4 program, and we want her to have access to that K-4 program all day, not just an hour, not just 2 hours. We want it all day. And again, the whole point is that in that entire day, imagine not having access to the education and communication with your peers, your teachers, and others. Within a school system, we need to support our deaf children and their access to education through services such as our language. So thank you for listening. I appreciate it. That's a great question. And two things I'd like to say about that. For example, like my daughter, for a while there, we had her homeschooled. She uses hearing aids, and they have what's called boots. So her teacher uses what's called an FM system, and it's supposed to channel the teacher's voice to the hearing aid, but it doesn't work. So, like, for example, she's too far away from the transmitter, or she leaves the room, or they're just like, so many connection issues are a problem, and she can't get access to those things. So as a parent, it's hard to imagine what her day looks like without having the access. My second daughter, again, she uses sign language, but her teachers maybe know some basic signs, but they're not fluent in it. We want somebody who's fluent in accessing the language. So because my daughter can't read, she's not, and she's using sign language, she doesn't use speech for communication. So again, we keep going through the struggle of the school systems because they don't provide communication access. Now that's just my children's experience. Imagine what other children are going through across the state with varying levels of hearing loss and communication access. Now, my experience working with school systems as a deaf parent, if you were curious, now, well, for example, that mission could be that source to advocate on behalf of deaf parents in situations where they need support for having themselves to get access to their child education or for deaf children to get access to their education. My answer to that is the deaf mission. We need a role in the state at that level.
Going to be available to us, and that is why we need to solve a lot of the problems that we currently
Because I want you to speak up for yourself and talk about what you experienced as an individual going to the bathroom.
Yeah. But I wanted to know how to say, go Packers. Can you show me?
Thank you.